By golly, it's amazing. It sounds like something you'd hear on the radio.
Presenting the transcription feature.
The Lucky Strike program starring Jack Benny with Mary Livingston, Phil Harris, Rochester, Dennis Day, and yours truly, Don Wilson.
It's 8:30 New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the expert.
From Hollywood, it's time now for...
Johnny Dollar.
Kraft presents The Great Gildersleeve. Yeah.
And now meet Dick Calmer as Boston Blackie.
It's the Phil Harris-Alice Faye Show, presented transcribed by the makers of Rexall Drug Products.
And now it's time to meet the men from the ministry.
The Armed Forces Radio and Television Service presents the Bob Hope Show with Les Brown and his band of renown. And yours truly, Bill Goodwin. And now here he is, Bob Hope.
Greetings. I'm Kevin Lauderdale. It seems like just about every TV show, radio show, has at least one Christmas episode. It's always good for the franchise. And possibly the first recurring character in popular fiction was Sherlock Holmes, as created by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. So, naturally, there's a Christmas Holmes story. It's The Adventure of the Blue Carbuncle. It was first published in the Strand magazine in January of 1892, and it appears in the collection The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. What's a carbuncle? It's a gemstone, like a garnet, usually red. There have been many radio incarnations of Holmes, and we're about to hear two of the finest actors of the 20th century, Sir John Gielgud as Holmes and Sir Ralph Richardson as Watson. This particular series was produced by the BBC in 1954, specifically with the idea of distribution to the United States. The stories stick to the original texts and don't feature the bumbling Watson you may be familiar with in other incarnations. And their plan worked because this series ran on NBC starting in 1955. I always explain, say, World War II era references, so I might as well explain the one Victorian era reference that's in this episode. A gasogene stand. What is a gasogene? It's simply a Victorian carbonated water-making machine. You imagine a soda siphon, you know, the sort of thing Bugs Bunny would chase Daffy Duck around with, spraying him? Yeah. So it produces carbonated water for your whiskey and soda, brandy and soda, things like that. I like this episode, well, this adventure, if you will, a lot. It's got a really twisty plot, some naturally occurring humor, and it's full of the Christmas spirit. You're going to love it. From March 13th, 1955... The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, The Blue Carbuncle.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, the original and immortal stories of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, dramatized anew with Sir Ralph Richardson as Dr. Watson, and Sir John Gielgud in the role of Sherlock Holmes.
Christmas in our London of the 1880s. With a sparkle round the gas lights and a glow on the hurrying passers-by laden with mysterious parcels. With candles, shop windows heaped with toys. With tinkling hansoms hastening past. With a million tall trees and a million tall drawing rooms. Christmas. And in the glow and glory of it, I called at Baker Street to see my old friend Sherlock Holmes. Compliments of the season, Holmes.
Eh, who? What? Who's that?
Compliments of the season, Holmes.
Oh, Watson, it's you. Good evening. How'd you do?
Well, I must say that's a deuce cold greeting for the time of year. But don't you believe in the Christmas spirit?
Yes, yes, of course I do, my dear fellow. It's only that I'm profoundly engaged. My mind was elsewhere. Close the door, Watson, and come in. There's a confounded din from the street. Yes, that's much better. Sit down, won't you?
Of course, if you're engaged, Holmes, I'd better not stay. I've still some visits to make to my patients.
No, of course. You know how glad I always am to have you, old friend, to discuss my problems with. Now, help yourself to a whiskey and soda, Watson.
Oh, thank you.
And just tell me what you think of that.
Think of what?
That. Hanging on the back of the chair there. I've been contemplating it for the last half hour.
But it's only a hat, a simple, hard, black hat.
Just so.
You best sit down with me by the fire and tell me all about it. And I'll brew some punch.
Excellent, excellent, Watson. You know where everything is, of course. And meanwhile, I'll tell you the tale of this hat. And I ask you to consider it, Watson, not as a battered old billycock, but as an intellectual problem.
Well, let me find the nutmeg grater first and I'm ready. Here it is.
Well, then. You know Peterson, the commissionaire at the hotel on the corner?
But of course. Why? Is it his hat?
No, his trophy.
Huh? Trophy?
Well, he found it. The owner is unknown. It arrived here, Watson, in company with a fine fat goose, which I have no doubt at this moment is roasting merrily in front of the Peterson's fire.
Oh, well. A goose and a hat. No doubt the connection's obvious, but where do you put the lemons, my dear fella?
Lemons? Oh, try the gazogene stand.
No?
Oh, well, then that hideous bamboo smoking companion that Mrs. Hudson will insist on sitting down beside the sofa every afternoon.
Ah, yes, here we are.
Well, now the facts are these, Watson. Peterson, who's a very honest fellow, as you know, was returning about 4 o'clock this morning from some small seasonal jollification and walking homewards down the Tottenham Court Road.
Oh, stir the fire a bit, will you? My hands are full.
Certainly, Watson. Of course. In front of him, there in the gaslight, Peterson suddenly saw a tallish man with a stick walking with a slight stagger and carrying a white goose over his shoulder.
Uh-huh.
As he reached the corner of Warren Street, this man was suddenly set upon by a crowd of roughs. One of them knocked his hat off, and as he raised his stick to defend himself, he accidentally swung it against a shop window and smashed the glass.
Oh, well, what happened next, Holmes?
Well, Peterson, who was still wearing his commissionaire's uniform, rushed to the man's assistance. But the fellow, shocked at breaking a window and seeing a man in uniform running up to him, dropped his goose and took to his heels. The roughs did the same, leaving Peterson master of the field of battle. He brought both bird and hat to me. There was a card on the bird's leg with "For Mrs. Henry Baker" written on it, and the initials HB are written on the label inside the hat.
Uh-huh.
But of course there are some thousands of people named Baker in this great city of ours, so it has been my little occupation for this last hour or so to try and deduce the exact identity of this one.
From his hat?
Yes, Watson. The owner of this hat, Watson, highly intellectual, fairly well-to-do, but in the space of the last 3 years seems to have fallen on evil days. He used to have foresight, but he has less now than formerly. I suspect he's taken to drink, which would also perhaps account for the fact that his wife no longer loves it.
Oh, my dear.
Middle-aged, goes out little, has grizzled hair, which he anoints with lime cream, and has been to the barber's lately. It is also extremely improbable that he has gas laid on in his house.
Ah, oh, come on. No, you're surely joking.
Not at all.
I've seen you at this kind of thing before, of course. But this is going too far. His wife, Holmes.
Ah.
You said she'd stopped loving him.
The hat hasn't been brushed for weeks, my dear fellow.
Ah?
Well, when I see you, Watson, with such an accumulation of dust on your respectable headgear, I shall expect you to be returning to your old quarters here within the next day or two.
Oh, you know, you've an answer for everything. Wonderful, wonderful. Except the gas. The fact that there's no gas laid on in his house. Now, that really is impossible.
Not at all. One tallow stain, or even two, might come by chance. But when I see no less than five, I think there can be little doubt that the owner must be brought in frequent contact with burning tallow. Yes, he probably walks upstairs at night with his hat in one hand and a guttering candle in the other. Anyhow, he never got tallow stains from a gas jet. Satisfied?
Palmasso is very, very most ingenious.
Elementary, my dear Watson.
Well, I must say it seems rather a waste of your talents that there's been no crime committed. Nothing but the loss of a Christmas goose.
That goose, my dear fellow.
Mr. Holmes, are you in?
Hello, what's this? Who is it? Yes, come in.
Mr. Holmes.
My dear Peterson.
Oh, it's the goose, sir.
Well, has it returned to life and flapped off through the kitchen window? You're as white as a sheet.
Oh, well, see here, sir. Here. Look what my wife found inside its crop.
Watson. Look.
This is treasure trove indeed, Peterson.
Yes.
A precious stone. One of the biggest I've ever seen.
It's more than a precious stone, Watson. It's the precious stone. The Blue Carbuncle.
Great heavens. The Countess of Morcar's?
Precisely. Missing for 5 days and with a descriptive advertisement every morning in the Times about it. And a reward of £1,000 for its recovery.
£1,000? Cool. Love a duck.
A goose, Peterson.
Oh. The Blue Carbuncle.
Yes, I remember now. Lost at the Hotel Cosmopolitan.
That's it. And they've arrested some plumber fellow who's supposed to have taken it from the Countess's jewel case.
£1,000 reward. Oh, cool.
I was reading about it only just now. Yes. Here we are. The Hotel Cosmopolitan jewel robbery. John Horner, plumber, 26, was brought up on the charge of having abstracted from the jewel case of the Countess of Morcar the valuable gem known as the Blue Carbuncle.
What else, Watson?
Well, it seems that this fellow Horner was taken up to the Countess's room by her maid, a girl called Catherine Cusack, to do some kind of repair.
Mm.
When the head attendant of the hotel went in, a fellow called James Ryder, to see if the work was finished, he found the jewel case was lying empty and that Horner had gone. Well, he gave the alarm, and Horner was found by the police, and they arrested him. The case has been referred to the assizes.
Mm. Well, then, the only problem remaining to be solved is the sequence of events leading from an empty jewel case in a hotel room at one end to the crop of a goose in the Tottenham Court Road at the other. Just give me a pencil and that slip of paper, will you, Peterson?
Huh? Oh, yes, sir. £1,000. Oh, blow me down. Here, sir.
What are you going to do, Holmes?
Find the owner of this hat. H.B. Henry Baker. Yes, he began as a joke, and now he's become a mystery. We'll try the simplest method first. An advertisement. How's this, Watson? Read it.
Found at the corner of Warren Street, a goose and a black felt hat. Mr. Henry Baker can have the same by applying at 6:30 this evening at 221 Baker Street.
Clear and concise, I think. Yes, if you've quite recovered from your astonishment, Peterson.
Sir?
Just run down to the advertisement office and have this put in all the evening papers, will you?
All of them, sir?
All of them. Oh, and by the way, Peterson.
Sir?
On your way back, just see if you can buy another goose.
Another goose, sir?
Yes, as near as possible the same size as that one that your family is about to devour.
Oh, yes, sir. You're going to keep the stone, sir?
Yes, here, in my strong box. And I'll just drop a note to the Countess to say we've found it. Hurry up, Peterson.
Oh, yes, sir. £1,000. Of course, stone of crows.
No, the geese, Peterson.
Mr. Henry Baker, if I'm not mistaken. Do come in, Mr. Baker.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Sit down, won't you? Pray sit down.
Thank you.
This is my good friend, Dr. Watson.
How do you do, sir?
How do you do?
Mayn't I help you to a whiskey and soda, Mr. Baker?
Oh, thank you. I'll leave out the soda, if I may, Mr. Holmes.
Oh, of course. You see, Watson.
Congratulations, Holmes. The very man as you described him.
I beg your pardon.
Oh, nothing, sir. Forgive us. A private matter. Huh?
Now, Mr. Baker, you've come, haven't you, in answer to my advertisement. Is this your hat?
This? Oh, yes, sir. Undoubtedly.
Then pray allow me to return it to you with my compliments. The bird, I am afraid, we've been compelled to eat.
What? Oh, dear.
Careful, Mr. Baker. You'll spill your drink.
It was quite a necessity, I'm afraid, since in these modern days we seem to have lost the art of refrigeration in which our Elizabethan ancestors were so adept. However, there's this other bird here on the sideboard to which you're extremely welcome as a replacement.
That's uncommonly kind of you, sir.
Not at all. Of course, we still have the feathers and the crop of your own bird, if you'd like to take them too.
Oh, you're an honest man, sir, but the disjecta membra of my late acquaintance are hardly likely to be of much use to me. But I will have one more drink, if I may. Very small.
Most certainly. Would it trouble you, Mr. Baker, to tell me where you got that uncommonly fine bird of yours?
Not at all, sir. I'm a member of a Christmas goose club run by the landlord of the Alpha Inn near the museum.
The Alpha Inn, Watson?
I got it there in exchange for my weekly fourpences, which I've been paying since last April.
Well, that's good value for 12 shillings, Mr. Baker, eh?
Yes. I really am most grateful to you for your kindness, sir. I was set on by some roughs in the street, and I lost it.
All's well that ends well, Mr. Baker. We were fortunate enough to find it, so here's your hat.
Thank you.
And here is your new bird. Oh, I've put the old ticket onto it, the one that was tied to the other goose's leg, marked to Mrs. Henry Baker.
Oh, how nice of you. I'm much obliged, sir.
Well, not at all. A peace offering, Mr. Baker.
A peace offering, sir, in point of fact, to my better half.
Ah, quite.
Good night, sir, and thank you again.
Good night, Mr. Baker.
Good night, sir.
Well, so much for Mr. Henry Baker, Watson.
Well, it's quite evident that he was innocent, of course, from the trap you laid. I mean, about the feathers and the crop.
Yes, evident. I suggest, Watson, that we turn that proposed dinner of ours into a late supper. I'll tell Mrs. Hudson, she'll forgive us. And in the meanwhile, let's follow up the clue of the Alpha Inn.
By all means, Holmes, I confess I'm most intrigued.
As I'm afraid we shall have to battle our way out through those infernal waits who are making night so hideous on our humble doorstep. Come, Watson, we've work to do this Christmas Eve.
It was a bitter night, and so we drew on our ulsters and wrapped our mufflers about our throats. We swung through the doctor's quarters of Wimpole Street and Harley Street, and so along the great thoroughfare of Oxford Street, where the crowds were thinning now, to Bloomsbury. And there, in a forgotten corner, we found the Alpha Inn. And from the rosy landlord, learnt that the geese for his Christmas club had come from a dealer named Breckenridge in Covent Garden. Yes, here's the market, Holmes. What was the name of the goose dealer?
Breckenridge, Watson. Yeah, there it is, you see? The largest stall of the lot. There's the name written up over it.
Yes, just in time. They're closing up. Horsey-looking fella, isn't he?
What's that you say? Horsey? Good for you, Watson. That fact might come in useful. Ah, good evening, Mr. Breckenridge. It's a cold night.
Cold enough, I reckon. Glad to get finished.
Sold out of geese, I see.
Let's have 500 tomorrow morning.
Ah, that's no good, I'm afraid. We want one tonight.
Here, there's someone that stall over there with a gas flare. Now, excuse me.
Oh, we were recommended to you particularly, Mr. Breckenridge.
Oh, who by?
By the landlord of the Alpha Inn in Bloomsbury.
Yes, you supplied him with some incomparable birds, he told us. Where did you get them from, by the way?
Now, look here. What exactly are you driving at, mister?
Why, nothing, only that I wanted to know who sold you those geese.
I'm dashed if I tell you, then. You're another one to pester me, are you?
Another one? What do you mean?
When I pay good money for a thing, that should be the end of it, I say. But it's, where are those geese, and who did you sell those geese to, till I'm sick of it? You'd think that lot were the only geese in the world, the way some folk keep on at me about them.
Well, I can assure you that we've nothing to do with any other people who've been making inquiries, Mr. Breckenridge. In fact, all I'm concerned with is a little bet I've made.
A bet?
Just so. I'm always ready to back my opinion, and I've bet a fiver with my friend the doctor here that the bird we ate from the Alpha Inn was country bred.
You've lost your fiver then, because it was town bred.
No, 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 it was nothing of the kind.
It was, I tell you. God, do you think you know more about fowls than I do when I've been in the trade, man and boy?
But I tell you, it's country bred.
Each town. Here, will you take a bet with me too?
With pleasure. A sovereign, every penny of it.
Right, it's on now. Where's that ruddy book of mine? Ha-ha, here it is. Here, just look in there, Mr. Cocksure.
Well, what's this?
That's the list of the folk I buy from, see? And what I do with the stuff when I bought it. Now then, look at that name there, do you see?
Can you see it, Watson, in this light?
Yes, yes. Mrs. Oakshott, isn't it?
That's right, Mrs. Oakshott. And what's the address, eh?
117 Brixton Road, egg and poultry supplier.
Brixton Road, Mr. Iron Mighty. And what's the last entry under it, eh?
December the 22nd, 24 geese at 7 and 6.
And who were they sold to, eh?
Sold to Mr. Windigate of the Alpha at 12 shillings.
Right. And so what do you say now, Mr. Blooming Poultry Fancier?
Well, I must say I could have sworn it was country bred. All right, you win, Mr. Breckenridge. There's your sovereign.
Thank you.
Come along, Doctor. I owe you five, I think.
Yes, you do.
Easy money, that's what I say. Well, good evening, gents. A Merry Christmas.
Good evening, Mr. Breckenridge.
Here, come on, Charlie. Get all this stuff cleared away.
Well, Watson, let's stand here by the gas lamp for a moment. I want to think.
I tell you, I don't know nothing about it.
Well, you're ready well all to then. Thank
you get out of here, I'll say.
I'll stay where I want.
You're what is it?
Hello, what's going on?
Was there some kind of a quarrel, Holmes, back there at Breckenridge's store?
Oh, yes, so there is. Let's see what's the matter.
Look, look, that little rat-faced fella, do you see? Breckenridge is threatening him.
Now, I tell you, I've had enough of you angel blooming geese.
I was only asking you.
Yeah, well, you've asked the same before and you've got the same ruddy answer. You ain't anybody else.
One of them geese was mine, I say.
Well, you can ask Mrs. Blooming Oakshot for it.
She told me to ask you.
Yeah, then you can ask the King of Prussia for all I care. You get off now. Go on, I'll knock your teeth out, mind you. Here,
here. He's gone. Oh, give it a minute of teeth, honey boy.
Go on, you blooming nosy porker, you.
The little fellow's coming this way, Watson. It looks as if we've saved our trip to Brixton.
You want me to collar him?
Stand by if he gets nasty. He looks a bit of a shrimp, though. Not much trouble. Here, my man. Not so fast. I'd just like a word with you.
What? Here, who are you? What do you want?
I couldn't help overhearing your little disagreement with the good salesman over there, and I think I might be able to assist you.
How do you mean? How could you know anything? Who are you, eh?
My name is Sherlock Holmes, and it's my business to know what other people don't know.
Well, you can't know anything about this.
On the contrary, you're trying to trace some geese, which were sold by a Mrs. Oakshott, to that man there who sold them to the landlord of the Alpha Inn, who got rid of them through his goose club, of which Mr. Henry Baker is a member.
What? Why, you're the very man I've been looking for, Mr. Holmes. Oh, I can hardly tell you how much it means to me.
Watson, be good enough to signal for a four-wheeler, will you?
Yes, certainly.
I think, my friend, that we'd better discuss this whole matter in some cozy place, rather than in the crowded street. We'll go to my room, shall we? Oh, what's your name, may I ask?
My name's Robinson. John Robinson.
No, 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 the real name. It's always so awkward doing business with an alias.
All right, then. James Ryder.
Ah, head attendant of the Hotel Cosmopolitan, yeah. I believe. Quite so. Yeah, you have the cab, Watson.
Just coming over, Holmes.
Splendid, splendid. Now, would you mind just standing on Mr. Ryder's other side and just take him by the arm, will you? He might have a fancy to go for a little walk. Well, now, here we are. The fire looks very seasonable in this weather. Do put some more coal on, would you, Watson? Now then, pray take the basket chair, Mr. Ryder. You look chilly.
I'll make some more punch, I think, Holmes. We could all do with a warming.
Thank you, Watson, if you will. You'll find the lemons behind you on the gasogene stand.
And the nutmeg scraper?
There, behind the Persian slipper. Oh, you might hand it to me, will you, dear fellow? I'd like some tobacco.
Certainly.
Thank you so much. Well, now, Mr. Ryder.
Yes, sir?
You want to know what became of those geese, Mr. Ryder, or rather of that goose. For I fancy it was only one that you were interested in, a white one with a black bar across its tail.
Oh, if you could only tell me, sir, I'd be that grateful. Mm. It's really mine, you see, sir. It was sold by mistake.
And a most remarkable bird, if I may say so, Mr. Ryder. Watson, hand me over my strong box, if you please. That bird laid an egg after it was dead, Mr. Ryder. The bonniest, brightest little blue egg that ever was seen. I have it here.
Oh, merciful heaven!
The game's up, Ryder.
Steady, man, steady, or you'll be in the fire.
Hang on to him, Watson.
It's all right, Holmes, I've got him. Almost fainting, poor devil. I'll get him a brandy.
Poor devil, eh? Heavens, what a worm the fellow is. He's not got blood enough to go in for felony.
Well, there you are, my man. Drink it up.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Oh, what have I done? What have I done?
You know perfectly well what you've done, Ryder. It only needs one or two more links, Watson, to make the case complete. Now then, Ryder, who told you of the Countess of Morka's jewel, the Blue Carbuncle?
It was Catherine Cusack, sir. I swear it was her idea.
The Countess's waiting maid, Holmes.
Exactly. And so you invented some excuse to send that unfortunate young Horner into the Countess's hotel room, and after he was gone, you rifled the jewel case, raised the alarm, and put the blame onto him.
Yes, sir, I did, sir. Oh, for heaven's sake, have mercy, Mr. Holmes. I never went wrong before. It was Cathy was to blame.
Get
oh,
up
please,
off the floor, man. It's no good kneeling to me. You didn't show much mercy to Horner, did you?
I'll leave the country, sir. The charge will break down against
him. Get up! Get up! Watson, help me onto his feet, for heaven's sake.
What I want to know is how the stone got into the goose rider. There, man, take another drink.
Well, it was all a mistake, you see, sir. Once I had it, I wanted to hide it somewhere. It seemed to burn a hole in my pocket. So I went to my sister, you see, to think things out.
Your sister?
Maggie. She married a man called Oakshot.
Uh-huh.
And she fattens fowls for the market at Brixton.
Ah, Oakshot, eh?
Well, I was thinking it out in her yard, see, smoking a pipe-like. And I remember that Maggie had promised me a bird for Christmas, so I had an idea.
You forced the stone down the bird's throat?
Yes. Well, just then Maggie came out to see what I was up to, and the bird got free for a minute. But I went and caught it again, and Maggie and I killed it. I had a notion to take the stone to a chap I knew up in Kilburn that told me once he knew how to get rid of stolen property. And I thought it would be safe from any search in the bird's crop, you see, sir. Even if the police did take it into their hands to stop me. They weren't all that certain about Orna, you see.
Ah, when you got to Kilburn, it wasn't there.
No, sir. So I rushed back to Maggie. By that time, all the other birds had gone to market, see. There was two of them with barred tails, you see, sir. I'd caught the wrong one after it had got away. I've been at that stall at the garden ever since, trying to find out where it had gone. Oh, Mr. Holmes.
Ah. Well, what are you going to do, Holmes?
I'm not quite sure, but I think, all things considered, it might be best to... Get out, Ryder.
What? You mean...
I mean, get out, man.
Oh, heaven bless you, Mr. Holmes.
I don't want to hear any more from you. Get out.
Thank you, Mr.
Get
Holmes.
Get out!
Heaven bless you, sir.
Well, well, a most singular and whimsical business, my dear Watson.
Ah, my dear Holmes, shouldn't you have turned him in?
Well, when all's said and done, Watson, I'm really not retained by the police to supplement their deficiencies. As soon as I send the stone back, the case against Horner will collapse at once. There'll be no witness.
But you're committing a felony, you know.
Well, it's just possible that I'm also saving a soul. I don't believe he'll go wrong again. He's too scared. Besides, Watson...
Well...
Well, this is the season of forgiveness, man. Listen. 12 o'clock. It's Christmas Day. Oh, pass me some of that delicious punch of yours, won't you? And tell me you forgive me, too.
Forgive you? In heaven's name, for what?
For being so surly yesterday morning when you offered me the compliments of the season. I return them now with all my heart. And here's your health, old friend, with my glass upraised. A Merry Christmas, my dear Watson.
A Merry Christmas, Holmes.
God save Her Gracious Majesty.
Amen.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, based on the original stories of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, have been dramatized anew with original music composed by Sidney Torch. Sir Ralph Richardson played the part of Dr. Watson, and Sir John Gielgud that of Sherlock Holmes. The program was produced by Harry Allen Towers.
Now let's jump forward from Christmas to New Year's. Here is another episode of the Phil Harris-Alice Faye Show. There is a reference to the fact that Bob Crosby had recently taken over for Phil Harris as band leader on the Jack Benny Show. The first sex change operation had been performed just a few months earlier in 1951, and Hildegard was an elegant, famous nightclub entertainer. From December 28, 1952, the Phil Harris-Alice Faye Show, New Year's Eve party at the Harris's.
RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, and first in television, presents transcribed the Phil Harris-Alice Faye Show. For your enjoyment, here is the Phil Harris-Alice Faye Show, written by Ray Singer and Dick Chevrolet, with Elliott Lewis, Walter Tetley, Robert North, Janine Roos, Ann Whitfield, Walter Sharp in his music, and yours truly, Bill Foreman. Have you ever planned to spend a quiet New Year's Eve at home? That's what Phil is planning for this year. Whether he succeeds or not is... But more about that later. First, a word from RCA Victor. At home or away, you'll have a world of entertainment at your fingertips when you own RCA Victor's smart new super personal radio. It's the handiest portable radio you can buy. No bigger than an average book. And it's so lightweight and compact, you can take it anywhere with ease. And tiny as it is, you'll find that with its room-sized volume and big radio tone, it's a match for much larger portables. But the advantages of RCA Victor's super personal portable radio don't end there. With new RCA Balanced Life batteries, it plays longer, up to 10 times longer than previous small portable radios. And its new battery lifesaver switch can add even more playing hours by letting the batteries loaf in strong signal areas. Enjoy music and your favorite radio shows wherever you go. Select RCA Victor's tiny new super personal portable for yourself or as a gift. It comes in a choice of six stunning colors, and it's priced at only $29.95 plus batteries, slightly higher in the far west and south. See and hear RCA Victor's long, long playing super personal portable radio at your RCA Victor dealers tomorrow. And now the stars of the RCA Victor program, Alice Faye and Phil Harris. Phil has told Alice that he doesn't want to go out this New Year's Eve. Alice was a little disappointed, but rather than make an issue of it, she decided to have a party at home.
Well, Willie, I called everybody, and they all accepted my invitation. There'll be about 50 people at my New Year's Eve party.
Sis, why make all that work for yourself? Why have a party? Why don't you just go out New Year's Eve?
Well, I'd like to go to a nightclub and celebrate, but Phil doesn't want to. He just wants to stay at home.
That's what comes from marrying a man so much older than yourself. That 20 years difference shows up at this stage of the game.
There's not that much difference. He's only 10 years older than I am.
Only 10? Well, how old is Philip?
Well, Phil is 47, and I'm... You're right, there is 20 years difference.
Philip has no right to hold you down like this. If he doesn't want to take you out, go out with somebody else.
Like who?
Call one of your old boyfriends, like Rudy Valley, Don Amici, or Rod LaRock.
Never mind. And look, Willie, don't say anything to Phil about the party. I'm not going to tell him about it until Wednesday morning.
Ooh, why not?
Well, because I'm inviting some very nice people. And if Phil hears about the party, he'll invite all the boys in his band, and they'll bring their whatever those things our musicians bring to parties.
Those are girls.
Then why are they all shaped like bottles? And the way those fellas act at a party.
Oh, Alice, you're just sensitive. Phillips' musicians won't do any harm at the party. In fact, if you keep them caged, they can be amusing.
Well, I don't want them. I'm using my good silverware and bone china, and I don't trust them. Well, if they don't break, they'll hawk. I had those musicians over here last New Year's Eve, and I'll
Oh, good morning, honey. Hey, did I hear you talking about musicians?
Yes, you did. I was telling Willie about how they acted at our last New Year's Eve party.
Yeah. Hey, weren't they cute? That was some New Year's Eve party. What a fortnight.
fortnight? You mean they stayed for 2 weeks?
Certainly. It ain't good manners to eat and run. I say run, they couldn't even walk. Sure was a wonderful New Year's Eve party. We had a lot of... Hey, Alice, I got an idea. Why don't we invite
No.
the...
No. Never again.
No, huh? Mm-mm. Well, maybe just Elliott and a noble player.
No,
you know.
No. No, now just forget about it and go read your morning mail.
Okay. But I don't see why we can't have a few musicians over. They... Hey, speaking of Elliott, look at this. He sent us an invitation.
To what?
To a New Year's Eve party at his house. Listen to this. You are cordially invited to the musician's annual New Year's Eve and sew up your own knife wounds party. The party will start at 8 o'clock and will last till 6 New Year's morning. Those who wish are invited to stay for breakfast and the reading of the coroner's report. Hey, Alice, I know I didn't want to go out on New Year's Eve, but I can't resist this invitation.
Well, I can. I planned on staying home to please you, and we're not going out. Call Elliott and tell him we can't go.
But, honey, Elliott's my best friend. I can't tell him we don't want to go.
Well, make up an excuse. Blame it on me. Tell him I'm sick. Tell him I have a streptococcus infection, and the doctor gave me a couple of shots and told me not to go out of the house for a few days.
Honey, I can't. Come in. Maybe I can tell him that.
Hiya, Curly. Hello, Alice.
Oh, Elliott.
I just stopped over to see if you got my invitation. Oh, it's going to be a great party. I got a pipeline from the Knickerbocker Brewery direct to my apartment. We're going to have a wonderful time.
Look, Elliott, we can't go to your party.
You can't go to my party?
No.
Why not? Am I too lowbrow for you people?
It's not only that.
I mean...
No, it's not that, Elliott. It's Alice. You see, she had a couple of shots, and she's in no condition to go out.
Can we put her under a cold shower and sober her up? Well, we can send her to my doctor. He has a new 3-day cure that's...
I don't mean that. The doctor gave her a couple of shots for her streptococcus. It's a Greek disease.
Oh, gee, Alice, I'm sorry you're sick.
So am I, and that means I won't be able to go to your party.
But, Alice, you've got to come. It's going to be a wonderful affair. We'll have about 200 people. There'll be all kinds of food and drinks, and I counted on your coming. I don't know what I'll do if you don't show up.
Oh, that's sweet of you, Elliott, but I just can't go.
Well, if you can't, you can't. I'll just have to get somebody else to wash the dishes.
Elliott, I'm sick, and I can't go to your party.
Yeah, I understand, Alice, but don't worry. You just go to bed and forget everything. Curly will tell you all about the party when he gets home. If he gets home.
Look, Elliott, if Alice can't go, I can't go. You don't expect me to go to your party alone, do you?
Of course not. I'll get you that red-headed manicurist that Joe's bought.
Elliott, will you please stop that? You think you can get her? I can stop in for a shave around 6 o'clock and... Oh, yeah, my sick wife. I'm sorry, Elliott, I can't go. Look, Alice, maybe by New Year's Eve you'll feel better.
Oh, no. No, I'm sure it'll be much worse New Year's Eve. In fact, it's getting worse now. I'd better go upstairs and lie down. Maybe next year, Elliott, if I'm still around. Oh, those pains.
Gee, Curly. I didn't realize she was so sick. Poor kid. You must be terribly worried.
Yeah. Elliott, who's coming to your party? The same gang?
Yeah.
Hey, too bad I ain't gonna be there. You know, that party ain't gonna be the same without me, because I'm always cracking jokes and I sing for the gang. I bet you're gonna miss that.
Oh, something fierce.
Hey, maybe I could sneak over New Year's Eve and just do a song, you know?
No,
and
no, no. Don't put yourself out. I'll tell you what. You sing to me now and I'll remember it New Year's Eve.
New Year's Eve is 3 days off.
It'll haunt me that long.
Oh.
Go ahead.
Won't you buy, pretty lady? Won't you try something new? Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy from me? Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy, won't you buy from me?
Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy from me? Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy, you buy, you buy, you buy, won't you buy from me? Won't you buy, pretty lady? Won't you try something new? Won't you buy, my pretty lady? They're all imported from the tropics just especially for you. There's a little fellow always in the park, selling nuts and candy, happy as a lark, chirpy as a cricket as he strolls along. Everybody loves him and his funny song. Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy from me? Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy, you buy, you buy, you buy, won't you buy from me? Won't you buy, pretty lady? Won't you try something new? Won't you buy, my pretty lady? They're all imported from the tropics just especially for you. Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy from me? Peanuts, popcorn, Cracker Jack, and jelly apple, won't you buy, you buy, you buy, you buy, won't you buy from me? Won't you buy, my pretty lady? Honey, won't you try something new? Won't you buy, pretty lady? They're all imported from the tropics just especially for you. Won't you buy, 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 buy, you buy, you buy, you buy, 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 buy.
Curly, that was glorious. Fast and glorious. Say, by the way, Curly, I'll need a few things for my party. May I borrow them?
Oh, sure. What do you need?
Oh, just a couple of little things. I'll need some salt shakers, napkin rings, napkins, tablecloths, candles, noisemakers, funny hats, cigars, cigarettes, flowers, food, liquor, and a full set of dishes for 200 people.
Why don't you take my kids, too?
Don't be sarcastic. I just want a few things. Oh, before I forget, I'll need some glasses to serve the champagne in.
Why do you need our glasses? If there's one thing you have more of than anybody else, it's something to drink out of. Why don't you use your own?
I'd like to, but I can't.
Why not?
My lily cups haven't come back from the dry cleaners yet. They won't be back till Saturday.
You should have sent them to a laundry. You get one day's service.
I tried that, but they put too much starch in them. Got so the cups were stiffer than the guests.
All right. I'll let you have the glasses and the napkins and the tablecloth.
How about the dishes?
I don't know about that. All we have is bone china.
We'll scrape the bones off. That'll be all right. Just give me a big carton. I'll dump everything into it and take it over to my
place. Wait a minute. You ain't dumping nothing. Take the napkins and that other stuff first and then come back for the china later. That's expensive stuff. I don't want nothing busted.
Yeah. Well, all right. I'll make two trips.
Now, wait a minute. I don't want Alice to see you carrying that stuff out of the house. I'd better check and make sure she's still upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, ma'am. Oh, Alice!
Yes, Phil?
Are you still sick?
Is Elliot still here?
Yes?
I'm still sick.
Good. Just stay that way a little longer.
I don't understand some of the conversations that go on in this house. Oh, well, I better take this stuff and get going. I'll be back for the dishes later.
I wonder if I ought to tell Phil about the New Year's Eve party I planned. No, I'd better not. I know he'll invite Elliot and all those musicians. Oh, dear, I hope that isn't Julius with the food I ordered for the party. If Phil sees it, it'll be a dead giveaway. Phil, who's at the door?
It's our gabby neighbor, Mrs. Stewart. I'll let her in.
Well, if it
is... Hello, Mr. Harris. I didn't expect to find you home this time of day. Don't you ever work? Seems every time I come over, you're here.
Well,
I guess when a man's married to a rich woman, he doesn't have to worry about making a living. I heard your wife is loaded. Offhand, how much would you say she's worth?
Well, I don't...
Oh, you can tell me. I can keep a secret. I'm very close-mouthed. Not a word passes my lips.
You must have a hole in your side. Them words are coming out.
You say the funniest things. No wonder you're on the Jack Benny Show.
Look,
you know,
I'm not
I love you on that show. But tell me, why did you change your name to Bob Crosby? I thought Phil Harris was much funnier name.
I know, but I wanted everybody to think I was Bing's brother.
Oh, well, I never think so in a million
You'd
years.
Be surprised the publicity you get that way. Next year, I may become Liberace's brother. And a year after, if I can get hold of that doctor in Copenhagen, I may become Hildegard's sister. There's just no end to the things I can become if I set my mind to it.
My, you're a gabby one, aren't you? Now, look, I just came over to see your wife.
Oh, hello, Mrs. Stewart.
Oh, there you are, Mrs. Harris. Well, I'm glad you're here. I came over to tell you I'm having a New Year's Eve party, and I wondered if
I could...
Well,
I'm sorry, but I'm sick, and I won't be able to come.
Oh, nobody asked you to. I just came over to borrow something. I'd like to ask you to the party. We were having mostly society people, and you just wouldn't fit in with them, dearie. After all, you show people aren't very good at parties except for entertaining. Of course, if you want to stop and sing a song or two, that'll be all right. But don't mingle with the guests.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Stewart, but I can't come to your party. You see, I'm not well. In fact, I'm very sick. I'd better go upstairs and lie down right now. Goodbye.
But Mrs. Harris, I... Well, she's a strange creature, isn't she? Oh, well, I just came over to borrow something. Now, what was it again? Oh, yes, yes, I need a cream and sugar set.
Well, Miss Stewart, the only thing we've got is a sterling silver set. It was a wedding gift.
Oh, that'll be good enough. Oh, I see it there on the sideboard. I'll help myself.
Now, wait a minute. That's part of a complete silver service. It comes with knives and forks, and Alice don't like to break it up.
Oh, well, I don't blame her. I'll just borrow the whole thing.
Mrs. Stewart, please, we don't...
Now, thank you, Mr. Harris. You're such a nice man. I can't understand why people are always saying nasty things about you. You're not half as bad as they say. Well, I better run along. I think you're a good neighbor, and if you ever want to borrow anything from me, just remember, Happy New Year!
I wonder how she'd sound with a mute. Someday I'm going to hold a derby over her mouth and get that do-what, 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 do-what.
Has she gone, Phil?
Yeah, she's gone, she's gone.
She has a lot of nerve inviting me to her party just so I can sing. I don't have to sing in her house. If I want to sing, I can do it in my own house. And I think I will.
Go ahead.
Thumbelina, Thumbelina, tiny little thing. Thumbelina dance, Thumbelina sing. Oh, Thumbelina, what's the difference if you're very small? When your heart is full of love, you're 9 feet tall.
9 feet tall, so very tall.
Though you're no bigger than my thumb.
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 Sweet Thumbelina, don't be glum.
Don't be glum.
Now, now, now.
Come, come, come. Thumbelina, Thumbelina, tiny little thing. Thumbelina dance, Thumbelina sing. Thumbelina, what's the difference if you're very small? When your heart is full of love, you're 9 feet tall. So
Thumbelina, Thumbelina, tiny little thing. Thumbelina dance, Thumbelina sing. Oh, Thumbelina, what's the difference if you're very small? When your heart is full of love, you're 9 feet tall.
That was very pretty, Alice. You want to know something, honey? Mm-hmm. I'm glad you got us out of going to Elliott's party and Mrs. Stewart's. You know, it's going to be a lot more fun just the two of us sitting here singing at each other.
Oh, Phil. Phil, there's something I ought to tell you. On New Year's Eve, I'll get it.
You better not. Might be somebody else inviting us to a party. You'll only have to run back here and be sick again. I'll get it.
I hope New Year's Eve won't be too dull with just Alice and me. I wonder if Alice would mind if I invited that red-headed manicurist over. The poor kid will probably be... Nah, better not.
Hiya, Curly. Came back for the dishes. Where are they? I gotta get them over to my house, then I gotta go shopping, get the food for my party, then I gotta start cooking it.
Today?
Sure. Party starts at 8 o'clock tonight.
But New Year's Eve ain't until Wednesday.
Oh, I know. We gotta get warmed up.
It takes 3 days to do that?
Certainly. That way, by New Year's Eve, we'll have a full head of steam. Where are the dishes?
They're in them two cartons. Look, you take one and I'll take the other.
Okay. Hey, it's heavy.
Yeah. All right, be careful with them now, will you? They're expensive dishes.
Yeah.
Hey, look, come on. We better sneak out in the kitchen door. Go out that kitchen way so Alice doesn't see us.
Okay, Curly. Hey, can you open the door? I got my arms full.
Anybody home? It's me, Julius.
Don't come in, kid. I'm standing in back of the door.
Don't tell me.
Look at that pile of broken crockery.
Hey, that crockery's moving. Looks like something's coming through it.
It's me. Julius, this is all your fault.
Why is it my fault?
I was standing behind the door with an armful of crockery, just like Mr. Harris is doing now.
Uh-oh. I see. And when I opened the door like this... You fell down like that.
That's just the way it happened, and you can see why it was your fault.
I disagree. Let's run through it once more.
Okay, I'll get another stack of...
Come back here! Oh, I'm dead. That was our best china. Elliot, this is your fault. If you hadn't barred the stuff, this wouldn't have happened.
I guess it is partly my fault, and I'm going to reimburse you the price of the dishes. How much do they cost?
$200.
$200?
Yes, and you're going to pay for them, and then I'll let you keep them. They're all yours.
All right. All right, I'll pay you for them. How do you want to be paid? I'd give you my personal check, my IOU, or my promissory note.
Now, there's a nice assortment of absolutely nothing.
Will you please, my checks happen to be good. You've accepted a lot of them at your market, haven't you?
Yeah, we have.
Julius, are his checks good?
Yeah. You roll them up in a little wad, and they make the best handballs you ever saw.
Why don't you beat it?
Not till I deliver the groceries Miss Faye ordered.
All right. Leave them here and I'll pay you for them. How much are they?
$300.
What did she order? Mink hamburgers?
No. She ordered champagne, caviar, and a whole truckload of stuff for the New Year's Eve party.
What are you talking about? We ain't even having no party. Alice couldn't have ordered it for New Year's Eve.
Curly, don't you see what happened? The groceries must be for me. Alice couldn't come to my party, so she's treating me to all the food.
Oh, that's what I say.
You say it for me.
Ooh-hoo-hoo. Ain't that sweet of her?
She's a doll. Curly, this gives me a chance to repay my debt to her.
How do you mean?
Well, I owe her $200 for the dishes I broke, right?
Right.
So I'll pay her back by leaving her my $300 worth of groceries.
Oh, now, wait a minute. That ain't fair. The dishes are only worth $200.
That's all right. She can owe me $100.
No, we don't want to be obligated. Tell you what, I'll throw in the refrigerator.
No, Okay, but the refrigerator's worth about $300. That means I owe you $200.
Yeah. What can you give me?
How much are those broken dishes worth again?
$200.
You keep them and we're even.
It's a deal.
Oh, I gotta stop coming to this house. That kind of talk could stunt me growth.
Look, Julius, will you be quiet? Deliver all them groceries. I want them delivered to Mr. Lewis's apartment. Come on, Elliot. We better get these broken dishes out of here before Alice...
Oh, Phil, Phil, something awful has happened. We've been robbed.
Robbed?
Yes, a burglar stole my silverware, my crystal glasses, and the bone china.
Now, wait a minute. Don't get excited, honey. Mrs. Stewart borrowed your silverware, and Elliot borrowed your glasses.
Well, how about my bone china?
That's the only thing the burglar stole. We tried to stop him, but he was a slippery little Dickens. He just flew down through the...
Phil, that was my good china. Phil, what are those two piles of rubble on the floor?
Where? Oh, that? Volcanic ash. Mount Wilson just erupted again. Got the news on
it. Stop that nonsense. What is that on the floor?
Oh, look, honey, I might as well tell you the truth. Elliot was barring your dishes and dropped them.
But, Phil, I have guests coming. My silver is gone, my glasses are gone, and my dishes are broken into a million... Oh.
Elliot, she fainted.
Yeah. Well, I better go over to my apartment and get things ready for the party.
Wait a minute, I'm going with you.
You're going to leave Alice unconscious?
You don't think I'm going to bring her too so she can beat my brains out, do you?
Don't you think we ought to wait till she comes too so I can thank her for the food she got me?
We ain't got no time. Just write a note and I'll pin it on her.
Alice and Phil will be back in just a moment. You can play any record, 45, 33 and a third, or 78 RPM, automatically on RCA Victor's new three-speed Victrola attachment. The center is the secret. Your 45 records fit perfectly on the large center spindle. Records change from the center, the modern 45 way. And this unique spindle slips off in a jiffy when you want to play your 33 and a third and 78 RPM records. So buy whatever records you like in the speeds and sizes you prefer and play them automatically through any AC radio, phonograph, or TV set on RCA Victor's new three-speed Victrola attachment. When you visit your dealers, listen to RCA Victor's new Glenn Miller album. It's Music in the Miller Manor. 8 wonderful hit tunes, including Intermezzo and Sleepy Lagoon. Ask for Glenn Miller Concert Volume 3 at your RCA Victor dealers tomorrow.
Folks, this is Phil again. As we celebrate this new year, this week millions of cars will crowd our streets and highways. In every car will lurk a grim menace who will turn pleasure into tragedy if he can. So obey all traffic regulations, stay within lawful and common sense speed limits, and refrain from drinking if you drive. Remember, traffic accidents have been piling up, a total of more than 30,000 deaths and over 1 million injuries each year. And holidays always take a tragic toll of fatalities and injuries. So keep on the alert every instant, not only for yourself, but for the other guy. Drive as if your life depends on it, because it does. Thanks and Happy New Year, everyone.
Happy New Year, everybody.
Included in this program transcribed was Lois Corbett. The part of Julius was played by Walter Tetley. A while ago, you heard about the latest album in RCA Victor's great Glenn Miller concert series. Now, a word about the first two volumes. In Volume 1, RCA Victor brings you Glenn Miller in actual on-stage performances of 8 jazz hits, including St. Louis Blues and Tiger Rag. Volume 2 presents Glenn Miller's renditions of famous favorites like I Got Rhythm and My Buddy. And both albums are available in all 3 speeds. Visit your record dealers tomorrow. Ask for RCA Victor's Glenn Miller concert albums.
Next, hear Theater Guild on the air over NBC.
That's your old-time radio fix for this week. I hope you enjoyed yourselves. Be sure to subscribe to The Chronic Rift on iTunes or visit us frequently at chronicrift.com.
What a voice. What a voice. Simply means ink. A dink-a-doo. A dink-a-dee. Good night, folks. Signing off.